cannabis, wiki cannabis. Various option tap man, you have to try one of these. Man, smoking like a 420. High grade weed off a plenty. Cannabis, wiki farm down a centi.
Welcome to Cannabis Wiki Dancehall Tours. You understand, we're live inside of Kingston, Jamaica, with a superstar producer from Head Concussion to a Rich Immigrant. You understand? Russian! You understand? Welcome to Cannabis Wiki Dancehall Tours. First, I must say, I'm very proud of you, my brother. You understand? You change the game. You see me, you do something we never know possible as a dancehall producer. To go over in a hip hop world and I take over, like say, live there. You like it, my friend. So, Cannabis Wiki Dancehall Tours is about how entertainers and people in the music world have vibes. Yeah. And I know so the cannabis is important. I want to know why, when Russian and make the rhythm demo, what gave the vibe and the energy from in the back in the days with the cartel production them and the one of them song them. What you use in the studio for give a boost? By the way, do you smoke?
No, I don't smoke anything, no cigarette, no weed, nothing.
So what do you use, like when you're in the studio and vibing, when you know the early days then when you make them one of them bad rhythm there for cartel, what did I use?
Nothing. The balance is
what all you get your dancehall vibe and the energy, so
it's just what motivates me is progress, you know. So just knowing if I'm at point one, I'm gonna reach a point 10. That motivate me enough to say, oh, I'm going to put in the work.
Yeah, so what the vibe, so that you have a natural high in yourself.
Yeah, I naturally have the energy.
So when they are when they're in the studio, you know, with them Spanish artists, they always want to see some of them big blood there.
Yeah.
You know, at the hot box in the studio, yeah, when you're alone, they smoke.
Yeah, from Jamaica to the hip-hop, to the Latin artists.
But how you manage with everybody
smoking? The second smoke,
yeah.
I mean, sometimes it reaches me still and I get high, you know, but half of the second and smoke, but if I can avoid it, I avoid it, because I don't, so me personally, when I've smoked weed before, it makes me paranoid. Like, when I'm laying in the room, I'm high right now, I say, yo, I'm going to order some of the weed right now.
I looked you in the video. So you don't do edibles or vape or anything like that?
No, so what I try out and I like to is the CBD. CBD is
it's for the nerve. Yeah.
Yeah, it's for the nerve. It just make you more.
Make it more. It doesn't give you a high.
It definitely just tend from working.
Yeah, it's more muscles.
Yeah, it's relaxed.
Oh, so you're more of a CBD person, not a THC person.
CBD. It's not something I do all the time, but when I feel like I look intense, you just want
to
see.
Oh, so you do it as a muscle relax type thing.
Yeah. Like
growing up, you just natural high.
Yeah. I only start. Use CBD like 2 years ago, I tried to LA. You know, LA had a weed place.
So you ever tried edibles like weed cake and everything then?
Yeah, you know, when we were in high school, when I originally baked some weed brownies, and I used to sell them, I would try a piece and it mashed me up start. Like,
yeah?
Yeah, and then one time Sean Paul gave me some weed oil from my little finger. I went, put it on, I taste it, and the thing went my high for about 2 days.
2 days.
Yeah, can't deal with it.
What? Oh yeah, y'all is there on the artist that must want the big blunts. Oh, you manage. Me still.
No, say, like,
but change. At once, a Russian.
But imagine this now. If me go try it and smoke with them, then we have five. I'm even.
Oh, the current line. I look what.
Yo. I'm not gonna concentrate on the music, is it? So to each his own, you know.
Okay.
Some might smoke.
But people, you understand what I'm saying? Russian has a natural high.
Yeah.
So yeah, I hear the whole heap of bad rhythm there from cartel days, from Shandy's strange face, the whole of them rhythm there is a natural high. And you're one of the few producers who can say that.
I think apart from myself, the only producer I know is
Steven. Yeah, it's you and Steven alone have that natural hype.
Yeah.
Because you guys came in music as a tender.
And funny enough, Steven had a studio like 2 weeks ago in Miami and he did bring some CBD gummies for me. And we'd eat some, but other than that, I know myself and Steven already messed with the weed.
Yeah. It was a natural hype.
Yeah.
But so, for your knowledge of the weed now, Your father smoke weed, as you tell me.
Yeah, no, I grew up around that somewhere. Yeah. I even remember my father smoking. From weed to chalice to all of that.
Which strain of weed in that one?
I think him smoked both still in sativa indica. Yeah, he was just a man who loved weed.
Oh, I just go straight through with it.
Yeah.
So how comes that never influenced you?
Maybe being around it as a kid, I never used to like the smell of it because it is sometimes, you know, weeds have that stink.
Yeah, that stinks, man. Especially mixing with
grandma. My mom actually used to smoke weed.
Mixing with grandma. So your mother, both parents smoke weed and you don't smoke.
Yeah, but she stopped smoking like 12 years now.
Yeah.
So, or it could be a little more. But they both smoked weed. They never smoked cigarette, but they both smoked weed.
No cigarette, and then was straight weed, both of them smoked.
Yeah.
And you, all your manage. People always I say the kids them, the mother them always I say the kids them smoke. And you, your parents smoke, but you don't smoke weed.
It's just so good. My sister too, she not smoke. I don't think none of my siblings smoke. One of them smoked cigarettes. And him stopped smoking cigarette, but other than that, none of us smoke weed.
So the song now, the latest song, the experience, the vibe, the lighter song now, the creator and process of that song. What everybody in the studio one time a vibe and.
So how that song was created? I created the idea from in America and had it, and then. Tarik and Shenseea wanted to do a song, and I said, "Oh, this would be the perfect idea." Mm-hmm. So I presented it to both of them, and then I flew to Jamaica and I recorded it. And I knew from the go before I even.
So you record both of them same time?
Yeah, both of them were recorded at Ramesh Studio, and before I even put out the song, I told both of them, "Say, oh, this song will be."
And if you listen to the album, it gets a digital mix.
Yeah.
It has a very high, like a high tapping.
Mm-hmm.
A very, very high tapping. I guess that's what the people them like about it because her voice is so isolated and high.
I think what people, for multiple reasons, they like it other than it being a super catchy song.
Mm-hmm. The vocals.
I think for one, them seeing Shenseea sing. And not no little ABC singing, like full range vocals. Yeah. They've never seen her do that.
Like Adele's type of range.
And she deliver it. Mm-hmm. And it's a new song to dance out to. And the greatest thing is that's a song where a kid can listen to your mom, your father, any age.
PG.
Yeah, PG 13. No, not even PG. PG 13. It's PG, So, no, not even PG. PG's parental guidance. It never need a parent. It's what am I calling
E for everyone.
Yeah,
E for everyone. So the song with Cardi B and Post Malone
and French Montana
now.
Yeah,
a history is set in our music with a song.
No
Jamaican producer has ever done such a big hip hop collaboration in the history. And I guess, you know, what people like about it is like always retain a Jamaican culture. It's like you like use it to surprise people that, yo, me looks like me Spanish, but I am Jamaican.
Yeah, you know, I mean, majority of the world thinks I'm Spanish or whatnot.
But when you embrace that, you're like, whoa, you know, this is coming from this culture. Such a diverse type of, you know?
So, you know, I
do a lot for the culture and it proves to people that, you know, Jamaicans can adapt to any situation. You understand? Because they normally limit us to one genre of music. Yeah. And you dominate dancehall and went over to hip-hop and dominated hip-hop. You understand? That is something great because no producer from Jamaica has ever done that in the history of music.
Sure.
You have produced the biggest crossover song in the history of Jamaican music. You understand? Only producers have been here before you, but you have made a legendary move, and I have to acknowledge that because it fly over enough people here.
Yeah.
You understand? I don't think they understand how big that song is. because the players that are involved in the song.
Yeah, no, it's definitely a big song and a big link up. And
yeah,
it's good. For
it's
the
a project. Very, very big link up, and it is very rare to know that it's a Jamaican.
Yeah.
Doing that.
Yeah, for sure.
You understand? Yeah. Jamaican doing that, brother, and you know, whole heap of producers I look for Russian now and I say, yeah, man, remember Russian Head Concussion for all them road days, man.
Yeah.
MC, man.
And then on the other hand, there's a lot of people who don't even know the story. A lot of people don't know, say, when I was coming up from, I mean, you know, because you're in the streets from 2009 to 2010.
Yeah.
It was in the streets from every ghetto, from Garden
to Rima to Rima to everything.
Everywhere.
You see me? Trying to know people and
yeah, giving out the CD.
Physically give out CD.
From where I go downtown, bus stop, I give out the CD them too. To all of that, sir. It's a growth for me and for everybody. And
so they do the street work. So it wasn't, no, yo, my fly up there foreign and get no big link. No.
Yeah, no, never.
We did have to pay with deals at Jamaica before.
Even when I fly go foreign, I swear, I never have no family up there. I did have a one aunt and a brother in Miami. My brother, both of them end up passing away when we were up there. So, like, just even knowing anybody in America, I never know anybody. It's not like I go up here with my whole family in New York or Miami. Or,
so you had to just
create
your brand. And know, say, this is what I have to do. It's this or never. Like,
yeah,
no
because
one
I
never.
Feel like, in dancehall, in Jamaica, if Billy Williams and was a hot producer and I did the touch the artist thing with Cartel and I feel like I reached a certain peak.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm saying, and I wanted to bring Jamaica to our next level.
So,
and that's when I start touching to the Latin market and link up the Latin with the Jamaicans.
Yeah, because the Latin market was your way into the hip-hop industry.
Yeah,
because you hit 10 times platinum in Latin first, and then they're like, who is this guy that is dominating the Latin market? So we have to add that in also.
Yeah.
So it's not only dancehall they dominate. They dominate dancehall, left dancehall, and went to Latin because you always had a reggaeton beat in all of your rhythms, them from Crown Rhythm and all of them rhythm that you always experiment with the reggaeton beat.
Yeah.
So I see the transitions from dancehall to Latin to hip hop.
Sure.
You understand? And then now you're coming and you're bringing in dancehall artists. You take Shenseea and make sure you do a song with Young Thug and Swae Lee.
Yeah.
You know, in our wildest dreams, we don't say enough people and say, yo, when will I do a song with Young Thug and Swae Lee? Young Thug and Swae Lee, a Jamaican doing that. You know? So that I hope now a lot of gates can hold up for people and let them see that, hey, Jamaica has the product that you guys are asking for to go on
the mainstream. Yeah, for sure. I feel like every culture takes from the dancehall and the reggae culture of Jamaica itself, from the music videos to the music to the lingo to everything.
And so, the next thing, though,
so I just want to know, just to know that if you really want a culture, you know, just
embrace
it. And embrace it and link up with the people from Jamaica,
because they make them more open-minded when they come towards us, because they were like, oh, I wonder if they can do this.
Yeah, I mean, like, look at example, you know, Black and the Dancehall.
Yeah,
we introduced him to enough of the Latin artists, especially like Nicky Jam and Fernando Lugo, a big Latin director. And if you look at even songs I don't produce, you see Blacka in about 20 to 30 of them videos, which is the culture, doing the dance, all of that.
Yeah.
So it's not like, you know, like bringing
in everything, that's the thing. You always include a Jamaican culture, it's the same thing with Kosi and and Conscience and Shenseea. That was the first link up.
Yeah, exactly.
You understand?
And
then a song they realize, say, yo, I'm gonna start involving my people in all my little Spanish and my little thing production them. I see you involve Conscience in the next one with Nicky Jam.
Yeah.
You see me, that one they will go big. You understand?
Yeah,
and that kind of
like five.
Yes, make people kind of love the vibe, and you know, people getting used to hearing dancehall artists on these type of beats.
Yeah.
So I think that was the beginning of the transition that we're seeing happening now.
Yeah.
Which where Shenseea can go up to French Montana and get a combination.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? American
artists.
She can go up to them and do that.
And
yeah, because the door was open.
Yeah.
And that door there, you got force open. You never went over there and said, yes, I'm a producer and Ray, and I'm producing hip hop and I'm good with this. No, you involve dancehall.
Yeah, always. You know?
Mm-hmm.
That's why I'm a tag.
Still use my tag. The A Russian, the people are saying, yo, cartel vicing everything on the French Montana.
Yeah, everywhere in Tafida, you know.
You know, somebody knows the cartel looking at himself and say, yo, this is the realest thing somebody has ever done for me in life. Even when he's not producing the song, he uses it. Nobody does that unless the artist is like the song of the artist.
Yeah.
You know? And you take that and turn it into your signature.
Yeah, no, you don't know him. He's one of the first big artists that ever give me the real strength.
Real strength. And, we know the table friend, but we know the beginning, man.
Yeah, that sample there, A Russian come from Life Sweet, that's
something. Mm-hmm. So when I remember, man, Clearance rhythm was the first rhythm we ended up trying to use. I ended up getting DJ Frosty.
Yeah, we get Frosty.
Remember, I made it up the road.
And then they build no fear for myself.
No fear after that, you know.
Yeah.
You understand? So people for understand that you try coming into music business, it wasn't easy because your rhythm, you'd have to give away the rhythm just to get people to voice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I know. Enough dues are paying from.
Only if dues are paying.
A lot of rhythms that wasn't produced by Russian, I built the rhythm.
Yes, for people and build many careers in music.
Yeah.
You understand? And we can say, you build DJ Frost's career.
Yeah.
You understand? The first rhythm is clearance rhythm, and I made it. Then remember me.
First three rhythms.
Yes, in first rhythm overall.
Yeah.
And me and you give him the rhythm. That was the start of his career. And Frost come no one win Grammy.
Yeah.
So you understand? So because of your selflessness, remember I said Frost can't play a key in a rhythm, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So if Russian never did selfless and say, yo, this is the rhythm.
Yeah.
You understand? You wouldn't have a next big producer like DJ Frost right now. So people understand, say everything that we do for one another, you know, it have a great impact in every way.
Yeah, for sure, you know.
You understand?
Frost, Big Bvng, and
From them time there, and you influence him into turning into a producer by giving him that rhythm. You understand? So so people don't understand, so there's a process enough time in their stages. Something might not be for you, or you give it to somebody else, it makes life for them.
Yeah, for sure.
Isn't it?
Even with YVP, Jamie Roberts. His first rhythm, I built it and gave it to him. The first rhythm Jamie ever recorded, I think, in a professional studio was for Jamie rhythm. I recorded him on that when Jamie was with YVP.
Remember. You know, so the whole new era of dancehall, you start them with them rhythm.
Yeah,
the whole new generation of dancehall right now, the youth, them where I build, and even a lot of youth tell me, say them look up to your style and patterns of rhythm. You understand, and the whole crossover type of vibe. Mm-hmm. You understand? And it's surprising to say, you're not a man about the cannabis, but a whole heap of thing, my brother, a whole heap of thing, and the people them like it, and the fans them appreciate what you do. You see, because they stand for the culture. Every time them see a post note, they say, upon the Jamaican youth.
Yeah.
Always.
Sure.
Always I represent Jamaica people, and this is Dancehall Tours, Cannabis Wiki. And we have to go into the story behind the thing, because a lot of people see the producers and don't know the process of creating music, you know? And everybody is unique in their process. You understand? And this is Cannabis Wiki, Dancehall Tours. And what's the next project you have for us right now? We have a job in November, October.
I mean, we're just finishing up Shenseea album.
Mm-hmm.
We just finished up King Kosa Project and Big Bvng. Those are my three artists. And then I have some stuff coming up for the Latin market and for the trap. You know, my next trap song is Rvssian and Lil Baby.
Yeah.
So look out for that. Sick. Yeah, you know, Lil Baby on fire. Yeah,
Lil Baby is fire. Man, I tell you, man, my friend, that's open the doors for the yard, man.
Yeah,
man. Right now, Jamaica, I got full up this end, man.
we have some new thing with Pantason and somebody. It's sick.
Crazy. Everything is crossover and a mixture. Kosa is a very good artist.
Yeah. No, I was trying to, because I feel like dancehall. What's the point of making a dancehall song only for Jamaica? The world needs to accept it, because if you not make something for me in life, if something I'll grow it dead.
True.
So you have to make the thing grow, you have to make the culture grow, you have to touch different audience and make them say, yo, oh, this is where it's from. Mm-hmm. And then when they investigate and say, okay, we like this song, what else is there?
Yeah,
if
yeah.
they want something a little more hardcore, they can look for that. Me personally, I like to blend everything so it can, you know, appeal to everybody. So it's just not just one set of people. Because music for me is not one set of people.
Yeah, you know? True.
Yeah. My mother never made music
for one set of people.
Even Michael Jackson and music will never die.
Yeah, because they experiment and all that.
And if you check it, anybody who made music for one set of audience, the music usually never...
It don't last,
or it don't touch, it touch the soul of everybody, no matter if them speak English or Spanish, French, wherever in the world. And then when you put on a Bob Marley, you know the vibes it brings.
Natural vibes.
Yeah, if you go to Spain, Ibiza right now and they play Bob Marley, it's the same vibe they're going to get here, so they're going to hear and feel.
Yeah, so when they're in Europe, they're not even steam.
Steamer.
Steamer, yeah.
No, you know, we can't. I'm gonna stay out for the week. I see you straight.
Hey, Mr. Me, I try everything. Go on, nobody ever want a slip style. No. So, if you ever smoke a slip, which trailer will you not smoke?
The upper. Or, whatever is the upper, which is the
Sativa.
Yeah.
You don't know the name of the Sativa?
No, I don't want life on camera and say that.
Yeah, no, but that's Sativa, the one that popped
up. Yeah, no, if I'm in the windstorm right now in LA, I'm going to say, listen, I want something that can keep me up, who not going to make me paranoid, and not going to make me feel down at all.
Yeah.
And then we recommend, them are the weed professionals.
Yeah, but I recommend white chalk or one of them. Yeah, so I yeah.
White chalk? That sound like coke. Are we named?
Yeah, man, are we named white chalk, man.
Serious.
White chalk, man. I said I want to know in front of your name, legendary. Yeah, this is a presidential role, weed roller.
So what is that, Jamaican weed?
Yeah, man, a Jamaican weed, man.
Okay.
Yes, they're legendary.
Yeah, funny enough, one of my biggest songs I ever produced in the world is called Creepy Cushions About Weed. Yeah, with Bad Bunny and Faruko. And that's what we put Travis Scott, 21 Savage, Nicki Minaj on the remix.
So, the Bad Bunny song where they do, where much of the whole of Costa Rica and place there?
No, the Creepy Kush down, it's the world they got.
Costa Rica and see the billboard with Bad Bunny with the same song.
Yeah, that's about weed, Creepy Kush.
Yeah, man, we never know. Yeah, man, and this one is OG Kush. And you know this program is sponsored by Outlier, me call it. Outlier, them say it name, but Montego Bay, Iron Shore Plaza. You understand? Cannabis Wiki, Dancehall Tours, and we hear Russian. I hear the biggest weed song I'm producing, Bad Bunny. Wait, name Cripple what?
Creepy Kush.
Creepy Kush. What does creepy mean?
Creepy? I don't know what creepy means. Is that strain of weed?
Oh!
Creepy Kush.
Oh, like OG Kush, Creepy Kush. Yeah. Oh, I think it's like a Latin word.
No, something. Man, it's an English, it's more Jamaican we hear about.
I mean, so you're supposed to can't speak Latin and Russian.
Spanish, I'm decent. I can definitely move around in the airport and talk to the artists I'm in the studio because they have to communicate. When I just met Bad Bunny, he knew zero English at Faruko.
Mm-hmm.
And know them can handle themselves and I can communicate with them.
Mm-hmm.
So,
who translated?
At the music translated, let's be honest.
So when in the nice studio, I said, pick up!
No, I knew some words, you know, and I knew words too. I knew the musical terms. Like, if I'm in studio recording somebody, I know what to say.
I said, do it again. Next, pick up and go again.
Like punch? Yeah. No, well, they still say punch in Spanish, like they know what a punch is.
Yeah, but which way that say? What would I say to them, like, to stop them, like, they're recording, like, something in Spanish that they won't understand in English?
Like stop them.
Like what you just say?
Like momentico. Like hold on. Like that's.
Oh,
like,
you can't say. You just say momentico.
Yeah, like that. That's like, or un momento.
Un momento.
Yeah, like 1 minute, something like that.
But that's the most used Spanish phrase.
I mean, they would. That's something that they would. Cause remember, they know I'm not Spanish, so everybody knows that. That's like basic 101. Mm. That's like somebody say wagwan. Everybody know what that is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So why you go up on a place you never have no family, you establish yourself as one of the biggest producers in that country. You understand? And you do that in less than 10 years, bro.
Sure.
You see me? Less than fucking 10 years, bro. It's crazy, bro.
Well, anybody can do it, you know, just to work and work and smile.
Yeah, but you have, to be, is the main thing where you set this up, outside your comfort zone.
Yeah, yeah, no.
You did not run anything. You were in charge when you left Jamaica. So I don't want people feel like, say, I cool on and left. You did not run dancehall when you left.
Yeah, because them time of straight jeans, hot.
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 Everything was hot.
Everything was hot.
Everything was hot.
Shandizzy hot.
Everything was hot. J. Capri hot. Shandizzy hot. Straight jeans, you hot as an artist. And a producer, and you went outside that greatness and that comfort zone to attain more greatness.
Yeah, no. Even in life, anything you're too comfortable, never good. I don't like being comfortable. I get scared. Like,
yeah, anytime you find yourself getting comfortable.
Yeah, like scared. Because at the end of the day, I always tell somebody, the bills them never stop.
Yeah, the monthly bills will always make
sure you like cover the person. Even if you own your house, you still have to pay it. Lights,
maintenance,
water, maintenance, probably tax on the house, whatever.
So
then your garden, them thing that add up and never stop. So if you feel like you can just stop, I mean, obviously it can take a month, 2 months.
Yeah,
depends well, you can't on, stop. Yeah, 6 months. Depends on you financially how you want to take a break.
Mm-hmm.
But me, I have to work constantly. That keep me moving as a human.
Yeah. That's that, your joy.
Yeah, that's my joy for no sense.
That's the thing. Because when all people hear and say work, it feels like, oh, exhausted. No, that like it keeps you when you're bored.
Yeah. But at the end of the day, sometimes it gets exhausting because music, people need to know, like, when a song come out, especially on a wider scale, not when you're just independent, it comes with no politics. It's not just about record a song and we'll throw it out tomorrow. Because, for example, you record artist A. Let's say you record Cardi B.
Mm.
We can't just throw it out there because, you know, there's a schedule of she
of
have a release of her album, so you have to respect that and you have to contact label them. I have to tell you, you can't release this, that. And then there's like also rights. You might can get a song for online rights only, but you have to have radio rights also because she might have 3 songs on the radio and you can't conflict with that because there can't be any conflict because one song will fight the next. Because there only can be so much Cardi B songs playing on the radio. So sometimes when the fans look at it and say, oh, how we don't see this there or that, they don't know if it come with politics too. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a lot.
A lot of technicalities.
Yeah, so sometimes creating the music is the fun part.
It's the fun part. Or distributing the music.
Yeah, actually get the business part. Business part of it. It's just like any other business or even worse.
Not even worse, yeah. It's more technical.
Yeah, exactly.
Like every step has to be registered before it is taken.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know, just doing there's a paperwork process of it. Where's them the major labels? Right now we're doing it. Like I just filled out one for a song, where it was recorded, who engineered, so you get the right credits.
Right.
What city and state? Who mixed it? The mix engineer. Was there any percussionist? Was there any keyboard player? Mm-hmm. All of them
additional details.
Any samples in there? How much you sample, who owned the sample, all of them things. That's why I personally don't sample, but yes.
Yeah, because you have to get clearance for all of them samples.
So there's so much to it where people need to understand that it's bigger than just music. It's music business.
So you yourself have a manager?
No, I don't have a manager. I've been self-managed my whole career.
So you deal with the business and the music?
Yeah, my attorney. So what I do is, you know, like, if a contract comes in, obviously he is still there, and just like I would call him and say, yo, what is your advice? And then I know with my experience what I want, and we figure it out.
So with that part, basically it's in a learning process for you also, because you're growing at the business side, because you already dominate the music side.
I feel like I'm always learning, but I don't know a lot of the business.
Know about the business side. Because you were always the musician.
But even back then, I read online. See, a lot of the thing is that man need for read because Google is free. And you read online and know, say, all right, this is what this means. And if you don't know, ask a question.
Ask a question.
Because you don't want to be tied up in somewhere you know, you're stuck with for 5 to 10 years and then you limit yourself. So so even as a younger producer, I used to be more savvy when I come out to the business because I used to educate myself and also, yo, at the end of the day, I'm not afraid to ask questions. Yo, what does this mean? Yeah. I don't want that. And if I don't want something, I tell the person, I don't want to do that. Like, this is the way I want to do it. Mm-hmm. And if you want to do it that day, we'll come to some even terms. So I was, it's about respect. You know, just respect
one another.
Yeah.
Respect where you work.
Yeah.
I don't feel like you're too big to take.
No, never.
Is it?
You know, I mean,
sometimes the simplest things can make a song a hit.
Yeah, of course. I'm a person where if I have 10 people in the studio, and even as him is a juvenile right there, sitting over there, I would say, you like the song? And they say yes or no. And say, oh, I like it, but why? Yes, but why? What about it you don't like? And then I think about it. Of maybe that's a point, you know, of why. Him say maybe, oh, I can't really dance to it that much. Maybe I say, oh, I need to put the tempo up a little bit more, make it more dance friendly if it's one of them songs. It's just about getting people's perspective. But at the end of the day, you have to know your vision. You need to know.
Just like when you're cooking food. You add what you usually add on if you want a little extra spice in there, extra that you just need to know.
You have to know your recipe.
You have to know how what is true to you, but still can incorporate.
You can incorporate other people's things. Like, you understand? And you hear the lessons, people. You understand? It's all about keeping an open mind in everything that you do. You understand? Never believe that you're more than the person to take advice.
Yeah, but even talking to Jamaican artists and artists in general, but I see it obviously with Jamaican artists because that's who I grew with. And we just don't even have this conversation with one of them in America. It's like, and I'm sure it happened to you. It happened to me too. When you're here, and this is the only thing you know, when you travel the world and realize the world really have billions of people and we this little circle. It opens your eyes to a lot of things. Just even dealing with people to different foods because I know some artists who say, yo, them up on the road and them used to go to this place in Europe and them used to say, yo, what kind of food that? And never want to eat it. So them stick to maybe a McDonald's or a Burger King, And then them learn it now. And then them say, Chano, I wish I didn't really
try
that food because now I love it. I will miss 4 years of my life.
4 years of it when I've been trying out that and trying to stick to the traditional.
Yeah, because in life, sometimes you try it. And even if you try it one time and don't like it,
at least you try it.
Yeah, or you can try. I believe you should try things.
Really?
Like food, especially 3 times.
Yeah.
Because, for example, you say you're bringing your youth from Canada or whatever, and we carry him go up. One jerk chicken spot there. So. And that one day,
it was a bad day.
Right? That don't mean,
yo, Jamaica jerk chicken is the worst.
What? Yeah, no.
Yeah, don't say Jamaica jerk chicken is the worst.
You might go to the same place tomorrow
and it's shot.
At
least give it three times.
Yeah, with food, you have to try at least 3 times.
Yeah, so you're a person that, you're not a student now, so what type of work process do you? Are you a person that mostly engineer or are you just make the beats?
I do both, but obviously the younger the producer, I was doing more of everything. Mm-hmm. Now, if I'm in a studio, I just engineered Shenseea 3 songs yesterday and all of that because me and her work in a relationship and I can work and engineer at the same time with her. Some artists, maybe like hip hop artists, I just have the engineer recording.
Maybe they
have, we're in a session with their engineer and I just give them the rhythm and then I just talk to them and tell them the direction.
Yeah, direction. But when you engineer it, it's like, it's when the more personal you get to the artist.
Some artists who quit. If the artist I know is like one of them ones who record like 30, 40 takes, then you know, say like, so I don't have that much patience. I'm a person, I have to work fast.
Take and copy and paste and say, yeah, man, that good, me fix it.
Yeah, exactly.
Remember, punch it, man. Yeah, man, it's always good, man. I would say, this is Cannabis we can dance out to us, people. The reason it was so good, I mean, I tell you, say, me, I'll forget, say, we do a talk about But big up everybody. Yeah. You understand? Big up God and God above all things. This is Pantason and we're live with Rvssian, the Rich Immigrant. Man. You understand? I will still say Head Concussion, but I don't know.
Yeah,
we're a Rich Immigrant.
See that? Head Concussion.
Yeah. Rich, you understand? Immigrants. Rich immigrants. You understand? You never say rich refugee.
Yeah.
Rich immigrant. Yeah. You understand? My friend go over there and make a life for himself and make a name and make a brand. You understand? And you boss all a label same time. You see me, brother, you actually don't know. Hey, told me proud of yesterday and even a water, you understand? Hey. Obviously, big up, guys. This is Cannabis Wiki Dancehall Tours, our next installment. You understand? Big up the fans in Canada, Brantford, you understand? Vancouver, Colorado, big up Outlay, big up Presidential Rolls. You understand? I'm going to say, big up Starbucks in Colorado. This is Pantason. Oh, there's a Rvssian.
Yo, this is Rvssian representing for Dancehall Tours, Cannabis Wiki. Check it out.